In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, good morning and welcome to worship here at Rose Park or wherever you are gathered this morning. As we have gathered in the name of Jesus, hear these good words from the book that we love. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing has come into being. And what has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of the world. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. Friends, as we gather as the people of God in the presence of God, may you be reminded and encouraged that though the darkness may seem grand and great in this season of life, be reminded and encouraged that no amount of darkness can ever overcome the light of Jesus. Would you pray with me? God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we gather as your people and we give thanks to your name and we praise you for who you are. We gather again in this rhythm of worship, God, and we pray that our distractions and the darkness might be kept at bay so that we can gather with humble hearts and open eyes, ears, and minds for this gathering of worship. We pray, God, for those who are struggling this morning, who are living in fear. We also pray for those who are celebrating and those who are surrounded by friends and family. We pray, God, that your Spirit might be upon us so that this worship might be fully given to you from our full selves. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus and for the redemption of the world, and let all God's people say, amen. Would you join us in this morning's worship?
Your grace is enough.
Series. We flip the pages of Scripture all the way to the end of Scripture, and we journey into the book of Revelation. And even at that word, and even from a distance, I can already sense and tell that some of us just got a bit uncomfortable. The book of Revelation is a bit intimidating, isn't it? It's a bit scary, if we're honest with ourselves. And that's because we're not quite sure what the book of Revelation is. Is it a book that is describing things that have already occurred? Is it a book that's prescribing what is to come? Others even think that it is a book that's describing things that are currently happening. Now, those are fascinating conversations, and I'd love to have them with you in my office over a cup of coffee sometime. But again, that's a conversation for a different setting and a different time. But there's one thing I do know about the book of Revelation, and that's the book of Revelation is by far a very, very different book than any of the other books in Scripture. Whereas in other books in Scripture, we hear the story, but we don't hear a lot of the details or the imagery of the setting. In the book of Revelation, you can't go two verses without hearing all of the colors, the blues and reds and greens and oranges and purples and yellows and golds. You can't go two verses in the book of Revelation without hearing the sounds, the rumbling of battle, the cracking of lightning, and those blessed trumpets that will not stop. The book of Revelation is a book that plays to our imagination and our senses. And so if you're willing in this series, allow that to happen. Allow your imagination and your senses to come alive as we embrace the book of Revelation. Keep in mind that in this book, there are different tones that it follows. There's a portion of the book that functions like a letter. There's another portion of the book that functions as prophecy, and still there's another portion of the letter that falls in line to the genre called apocalyptic literature. We're going to be spending time in the portion of the book that functions as a letter. Again, that's not to say that the other two are wrong in any way, shape, or form, but they're two portions that we can deal with at a different time and in a different place. So if this is a letter, then who is it from and who is it to? Namely, this is a letter from John. It's been debated about who this John is for centuries, but we know that the author of the book of Revelation is by a man named John. And John is writing this letter to seven churches on the island of Patmos. The island of Patmos is in the geographic location of Asia Minor, and John is on the island of Patmos because he's been exiled there for witnessing to faith in Jesus. So while he's on the island of Patmos, as you'll see, John gets invited into a vision from the Holy Spirit, and he is told to write seven letters to seven churches back in Asia Minor. And for our purposes, we're going to be diving into this letter, and we're going to be seeking to find, do the ancient words of the book of Revelation, do they still have power and wisdom to speak to the modern church? But before we answer that question, would you join me in prayer? God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, open our eyes, our hearts, our ears, and our minds to all the things that you desire for us to see, hear, and experience. And give us the courage to live this faith out. It's in the name of Jesus we pray, and that all God's people say, amen. If you have a Bible or a tablet near you or a device, go to Revelation chapter 1, so all the way at the end of the Bible. Revelation 1, verses 4 through 20. Revelation 1, 4 through 20. Hear now a word of the Lord. John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, and even those who pierced him, and all the peoples of the earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, write on a scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me, and when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet and with a golden sash around his chest. His head and hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand he held seven stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all its brilliance. I told you it was good. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and Hades. Write, therefore, what you have seen, what is now and what will take place later, the mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand and of the seven golden lampstands is this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Powerful and vivid images were displayed in this letter from John. John is writing seven letters to seven churches. Seven letters. When's the last time you wrote seven handwritten letters to someone? When's the last time you wrote one handwritten letter to someone? It just doesn't happen all that often in our current society. And that's okay, but there's something special about a handwritten letter, isn't there? It displays thoughtfulness and patience and care. And so when John writes these seven letters to these seven churches, it shows me that he's deeply committed to the Spirit, but he's deeply committed to the health and the wellness of the church. He spent time and thought and sacrificed to write these letters to the seven churches. But one question still remains. Why? Why did John have to write these seven letters to the seven churches? I feel a bit like my two-year-old son. The Spirit tells him, write what you see and what you hear, and I'm asking, but why? Why is it so important that John write these letters to the seven churches? Is something wrong? Is something good? Did he need to update them on something? What is going on? What's the purpose? Why does John need to write these letters? Well, for our purposes this morning, join with me and entertain these possibilities as to the reasons why John would need to write these seven letters to the seven churches. Here's the first. Maybe these seven churches just needed to be checked in on. Maybe they're really far apart, and they haven't seen each other in a really long time, and they haven't heard from each other in a really long time. And maybe John just needed to write these letters to check in on them and see how things were going. That could be. Maybe the seven churches, as another possibility, maybe the churches need to be reminded of God's authority or God's providence in a difficult time. Maybe they were concerned about what to do or where to go or when to do it, and so they simply needed to be reminded of God's authority and providence in a difficult time. Maybe they were doing something foolish. Maybe they were doing something sinful, and they needed a word of wisdom to bring them back to faith in Christ. Or maybe they were lonely. Maybe they were isolated. And maybe they needed to be reminded of God's shepherding care, that even though they are apart and even though they are isolated and lonely, that they are still a part of the family of God. Friends, do any of these possibilities seem to speak to today's church? Because maybe you're lonely, and you just need to be checked in on. Maybe you're really far away and you haven't heard from anyone or you haven't seen anyone lately. And maybe God's love letter is a letter to you, just checking in on you. Maybe you need to be reminded of God's authority and providence in a difficult time. Maybe you're wondering what to do and when to do it and where to do it or how to do it. And you just need to be reminded that God is in control of this difficult time. Maybe you're doing something foolish and you're doing something wrong and you need a word of wisdom to bring you back to faith in God. Or maybe you need to be reminded of God's shepherding care and love, that even though you're lonely and even though you're isolated and even though you're apart, we are still in this together in the family of God. Friends, the ancient words of the book of Revelation have tremendous power and have tremendous wisdom, and they without question still speak to modern church and to modern times. Because by writing a letter and sharing what the Spirit showed him and told him, John then, through the power of the Spirit, was able to bring truth, comfort, and unity to the distressed, to the foolish, and to the disconnected. Let me say that again, because that's so important in the book of Revelation. By sharing what he saw and what he heard in the Spirit, John was able to bring truth, unity, and comfort to the distressed, to the foolish, and to the disconnected. And friends, this is the very nature of Scripture. We believe that all of Scripture, from Genesis to Revelation, we believe it is all inspired by the Holy Spirit. So all authors of Scripture are in some way like John. They are sharing what they've seen and what they've heard through the power of the Holy Spirit. And by doing so, the Word of God has brought truth, comfort, and unity to the distressed, the foolish, and the disconnected throughout all time and space. But friends, this shouldn't end here. It shouldn't end. The truth, the unity, and the comfort should not end just at the pages of Scripture. Because just as we believe the Holy Spirit inspired all of Scripture, we also believe that the Holy Spirit is still inspiring. We believe that the Holy Spirit continues to work even through the book of Revelation. And so what this is all leading to and what I'm trying to bring us to is that each and every one of us should be sharing a letter, sharing what we're seeing and what we're hearing in the power of the Holy Spirit, so that we too might bring truth, comfort, and unity to all of those around us. Now, this doesn't need to be a physical handwritten letter, but we should be sharing in some way what we're seeing and what we're hearing in the power of the Holy Spirit. We should be sharing and showing it in the way we speak to one another. We should be sharing it and showing it in the way we act. We should be sharing it and showing it in the way we treat one another, in the way we advocate for one another. We should be sharing it and showing it in the way we work and in the way we play. When we share and show what the Spirit is showing and telling us, we then are able to bring about truth, unity, and comfort to all those around us. And friends, we mentioned this last week, but if there is ever a time that our community, our nation, our denomination, and our world need truth, unity, and comfort, that time is right now. And so it's my hope and it's my prayer that you and I would be learning from the person of John on the island of Patmos, that we might have the courage and the wisdom to share and show what the Spirit is showing and telling us. Because when we do, not only will we bring about truth, unity, and comfort, but we'll also be drawn closer to each other as we're drawn closer to Him. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, let all God's people say, Amen. Friends, again, it seems appropriate, given all that's been going on in the life of our community, our nation, and our world, that we would spend some time in prayer. And so, like last week, I'm going to invite you into a time of prayer, and there's going to be some time of silence, and that's okay. We're asking that the Holy Spirit would speak to us and to show us something so that we might bring truth, unity, and comfort to a lost and broken world. Pray with me. God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for this word written, the Bible, and this word made flesh in Jesus. We give you thanks, God, that the Spirit continues to move in and through us. We give thanks that the Spirit shows us and tells us and reminds us and encourages us through the power of God's word. And we take a time now, God, to pray, to seek the guidance of the Holy Spirit, to ask the Spirit, tell us, show us, give us hope, give us comfort, give us guidance and wisdom wherever we need it and desire it most. So God, we pray for hurting families, for victims of injustice, for those who are being silenced, for those who are shouting to be heard. We pray for the left out, the looked over, and the least of these. And we pray that the Spirit would show us and tell us and bring us unity and comfort and truth. God, we pray for our local community, our nation, our denomination, and our world. And in this time of silence, God, we lift up all of our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. God, we pray that we might learn from John on the island of Patmos, that we might embrace the vision that the Holy Spirit is giving to us for the future, so that we might bring unity, truth, and comfort to a lost and broken world. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus, and let all God's people say, amen. Would you join us in our final song this morning?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Thanks so much for joining us in worship this morning. We hope and pray that this worship and this word brought you closer to the name of Jesus. Before offering God's parting blessing to you, we here at Rose Park are currently working on a regathering process. Hopefully you've received an email or a letter about that regathering process. But it's our hope to remain online through Sunday, June 14, and then to gather for an outdoor worship service here at the church on Sunday, June 21. Please keep an eye and an ear out for that communication about the logistics of that worship service. On behalf of the leadership and the staff here at Rose Park, thank you so much for your patience, your grace, your understanding, and your faithful support through these unprecedented times. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord send his Holy Spirit upon each and every one of us, that we might be drawn closer to each other as we're drawn closer to him. In the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, let all God's people say, amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord, and we look forward to seeing you on the 21st.